welcome back to the Fox Robbins Business Show. Great to have you back. We have a special presentation this time. In fact, we're going to do two episodes back to back, and with a guest, with a special guest who's been with us previously. This is Peter Karlson, who is president of New Eon Corporation, is specializes in high tech, and is very, very knowledgeable about what's going on with small businesses. Although, having said that, you know, a small business is defined by the SBA as anything up to 500 people.
Oh, yeah, that's crazy, that's, 500. Yeah.
That's small to mid.
That's an SME for sure.
Yeah. If you're just thinking strictly in terms of the local plumber, you know, it's...
That's a micro.
Anyway, we're going to have two shows with Peter Karlson, and we're going to narrow in on technology trends with small business that all small business people need to know and to be focusing on. And I'm Bill Fox. I'm co-host of the show. The other co-host is none other than the scintillating, blazing, innovating, energizing.
Luminescent.
I'm still
luminescent. That's wonderful.
Coach Robbins.
Bill, how are you?
Good to see you, Coach.
Good to see you.
Effervescent.
Effervescent.
And our, as I say, our special guest for today is PK, Peter Karlson.
Good
to have you on the
show. Pete, how you doing?
Thank you for your help.
Thanks,
and all the people who are going to watch this show, thank you for your help. And so let's move right on because we've got a lot to cover.
Yeah, we do. Let's go.
And let's move into what number one is increased spending.
Yeah, I think that's actually a trend that's happening with reinvestment in the companies. So I think the companies and especially small business owners are saying that they're, you know, now their businesses are starting to grow a little bit. They're starting to think about how to invest in their businesses. And technology is a big piece of it because you get a lot of bang for your buck. And that's one of the things that we love when we see companies investing in, especially, we'll talk about cloud in a second, but looking at ways to make their business more efficient. So new systems, new processes, all of those things make your business more efficient. And technology is a big piece of it.
It's all about productivity in any business, and you're trying to get more output with less input. That's
Absolutely.
The bottom line of it.
Yeah. And
O divided
is
by
the,
I. And yeah. this technology, the slide says increased spending, and you were and I were talking before the show, and I said, it's not spending.
It's investing.
The CFO says, you've spent money.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
As the CEO, I say, I invested it, and I expect a good return on that investment. And you will get it if you invest in the right technology.
You will. And you'll see the return on the investment a couple of different ways. I think the efficiencies that your employees
exactly.
see. They may want the latest laptop, tablet, whatever it is. But if they can do things better, faster, smarter, cheaper, and get that information to their customers faster, that return, there's a lot of soft measurements, but there's
That's
return right.
right
there. Sure.
The bottom line measurement is the bottom line at the end of the year.
Our sales going up.
You got your sales
profits
went up,
going up. Right.
Your costs didn't go up as much.
That's right.
Your sales went up. Your profits are up. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Good investment. ROI.
Let's go on to Peter's point number two.
Yeah.
Peter, number two is cloud adoption.
Sure. And people don't even realize when a lot of, I talk to a ton of small business owners, they say, oh, that cloud thing, they're a little nervous about it, but they don't realize that they're already running their business.
Most of it's on the cloud already.
Yeah,
they don't know it.
And I'll give you two very good examples. Obviously, your website is one.
Yep.
And usually your email.
Yep.
And email and calendar and all those things. If you're not running in things like Google Apps for Business or Microsoft Office 365, you should be. And because, I'll give you a good reason, these guys are dominating the market. They're giving incredible service, incredible levels of functionality for peanuts of what we used to spend bazillions of dollars on. So things like Google Apps and Microsoft's Office 365 are fantastic cloud platforms. But also, you think about how many people are running QuickBooks. Well, QuickBooks, for the last 5 or 6 years, they've been in the cloud and pushing people to QuickBooks Online.
Right. So well, you can access it anywhere.
Yeah.
Look, you get a lot of small business people just simply know, what is it?
Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah. So it's not running, if you don't have something running in your closet, under your desk,
on your hard drive.
Yeah, something local to one of your machines, either your laptop or if you still have a server, we're going to always ask you why, but if you still have a server that's in your office, that's not cloud. And so the difference is it's something that you're running an operation out on the internet somewhere, and there's a lot of definitions of cloud. So is it a software as a service? Is it hosted? Is it, you know, there's a lot of little, you know, qualifiers you can say. But let's just, for broad purposes, say it's stuff that you're not running in your four walls.
In your building, yeah. Right.
But isn't it, wouldn't it be with the growth and interest and use in the cloud would mean that these things, I mean, I've got a computer right here.
Yeah.
This thing is gigantically powerful. It's got lots and lots of application programming.
Sure.
You know, so I can use it here locally, right. But as this cloud thing gathers momentum, these things can be less capable, so to speak.
And I can argue that you can do 95% of what you want to do on something like this.
Absolutely.
And so, or even better, you know, your phone. And yep. I would say that most business users don't need the power that's on those things.
Right.
Yes, if you are an architect or a designer, a mechanical engineer,
CAD engineer,
you know, you need some horsepower.
Right.
But most of us business users, you know, we're relying on, you know, we have to create documents, we have to write emails, we have to look at spreadsheets, you know, and that's really what we do. Or we're using specialty software out there that's on the cloud, you know, whether it's project management, whether it's customer relationship management, all of those specialty software, that's stuff that we can access better, faster, cheaper, smarter, again, through something like this than that.
Don't I have to worry, though, if stuff is out there in the cloud, it's not on my hard drive?
Yeah.
Am I in trouble if systems go down?
If systems go down, it's a different problem, right? So yes, there have been some cloud outages out there. So Dropbox is one that has had some problems.
Mm-hmm.
Amazon Web Services had a couple outages, and as they learn from, you know, we're all learning, right? So in the last 10 years, this huge shift between running stuff locally and running stuff in the cloud, these companies are learning as they're going, and they're doing stuff on a scale that we can't even comprehend as business users. They've got literally server farms that are, you know, the size of the building, and that you don't know where they are. You don't care where they are. I think the bigger problem is making sure that you have a great internet connection to get to it.
Right.
What did I hear? Iceland.
Iceland's a great place for
big.
It's cold.
Warehouse, you know, full of
computer. Yeah, it's nice and cold there.
And actually, in northern Canada too, they're actually talking about. So, I mean, what data centers want is they want cheap energy costs, and they want that cheap energy cost. They need power, they need cooling, and they need broadband.
Yeah.
And so you'll look around, and you can see this in a lot of places in the Northwest. You look at these beautiful hydroelectric dams.
Mm.
You see these anonymous-looking white buildings right next to them. There's a data center.
That's
and
right.
You'll never see a Google logo or an Amazon logo,
yeah.
But there's these giant, and they put them right next to hydro plants.
Cheap
or
power,
close.
Nice and cool.
And they pump the water in
right
from the water source.
That's right.
Cools all the
pulls
servers.
Everything.
Pulls it out, and you've got a little bit warmer water coming out the other side. So the fish are happy.
You got it.
We're going to move on to your point three that you made. In your explanation about this, about new technology, is mobile expansion.
And I think mobile is part of the conversation. No matter what your business is, you have it on your phone, you have it on your tablet.
I got my iPad.
You've got your customers, you've got your applications, you've got your documents, and you can access it all when you're on the road. And you don't have to fire up your laptop, you don't have to find a Wi-Fi signal. Phones, you know, and people, multiple phones, those people that work for larger corporations, they have their personal phone and their business phone.
Right.
Their business phone is really their link to the office.
So did Hillary Clinton.
Absolutely.
And if you work for the State Department, you're not supposed to use your cell phone. You're supposed to use the company email.
Yeah, right.
So that's the party line. Okay, so.
But this is, something must be catching on, Peter, because your number says 63% will expand. I mean, that's a gigantic number.
Right, and the reason why it's gigantic is because a lot of these, what I would call line of business applications, are now starting to introduce apps on the mobile platforms. Mm-hmm. So I'll give you a couple concrete examples. I mentioned QuickBooks. Well, QuickBooks, I can tell you exactly, you know, what our balance is right now in all of our bank accounts, and who owes us money, how many invoices are going out. I can tell you from this device, and it's real time.
Yeah.
And it's an app. It's right now.
That's right.
And the second thing is, you know, we're going to talk about customer relationship management, but that's a good example of where you want to have your customer data. You want to have that in your hand. Before you walk into that next appointment,
that's right.
You want to be standing in front of, and a lot of the
prepared.
Apps. And a lot of the apps are coming. They're, you don't have to buy them. They're part of, you subscribe to a program, you get the app for free.
Mm-hmm.
Project management's another great one.
You know,
where are we with that project? Boom, I look it up.
And that's now.
It's right
that's
now. And if people are updating it, it's real time. those things are all basically mobile apps.
See, you saw that in Spaceballs when they were watching, and this is now, now.
This is now, now.
This is now, now, right?
I was waiting for a Spaceballs quote.
I'm going to move on to number four.
Yeah.
Your point in this case is customer expansion.
Well, and this is no surprise that this stat, 25% of the small businesses don't have a CRM, a customer relationship management. And that's shocking, because if you're in business, you need to manage your customers.
Yeah.
And the most important thing you have are these customers that are paying you money. Yes, your employees are important, but if you don't have a customer, you don't have a business, you don't have employees. So how do you treat your customer? What do you know about them? Every, you know, like, dislike, their family
Absolutely.
Members,
your daughter's name, everything you can know about them, right?
Right.
And, because, and it is your employee's duty
Absolutely.
To know that
Yep.
and deal with that customer
Yep.
and make it very personalized. You bet.
And I think as small businesses get more sophisticated, these tools become easier to use too.
Right.
I think that, you know, you got this leveling of the water where the small business acumen of technology are starting to increase, but the technology that
it's getting simpler.
It's simpler.
It's getting more intuitive.
And it's approachable, right?
That's right.
So if you look at a CRM tool from Salesforce or any of the other big
Salesforce,
ones,
great. Yeah.
They are easy to use. Mm. And if I log a call with a customer, it takes me 2 seconds to
punch the button.
And I say, log this call.
Everything.
Yep.
And then everything you need to know, want to know about the customer that can help you make a sale,
yep.
is right there in front
yep.
of you.
And even and sale and service. That's the other
service.
Piece of it.
Well, service is going to bring them back.
Right.
That's how you build relationships.
And that's how you track. That's how you track what's going on
yep.
with the customer. So if you're walking into a check-in meeting with a customer and you see that they have 27 service calls that are still outstanding, you know you're going in with a firefight, because
yep.
you know you're going to have a bunch of issues to close.
And the CFO is going to love the fact. And understand the fact, just like the salespeople understand, it's 10 times more expensive to get a new customer to keep that old customer happy.
That's right.
And
That's
if
right.
you have all that information about that customer, you make damn sure they're not happy. They're delighted with you.
And they're singing
CRM.
Those customers are going to be singing your praises.
That's right. And they're your salespeople out on the road. So
absolutely.
You don't do business with them, they're great. You know what? I had a problem. They solved it before
yep.
I even knew I had a problem.
Yep. And that's how, one of the things that the CRM is a backbone of, as the stat says, is how do you acquire new customers? Well, you look at what you have in your CRM, and then you say, oh, we've got, 95% of our businesses that we do business with look like this. And here are the characteristics, whether
right.
what industries, what geographic areas, all those characteristics you can profile in your
right.
CRM. Then you can tell your salespeople, go find more of those. We know what they
target that type of customer.
And I'm not going to pitch Salesforce because it's very
yeah.
expensive for
it
small business, but there's a lot of tools built into Salesforce to say, I want to go buy some contacts with these characteristics.
Right.
Click.
You got them.
They bought a company
right.
called Jigsaw that actually now
right.
they call data.com.
Yeah.
But that's how they did it.
Yeah.
And it makes it really easy for companies to expand and acquire
Look,
new companies.
Look, on this point, I was going to jump your case.
Okay, go ahead.
Sort of. is the 25% have no CRM is the statistic.
Well.
Had I not seen this,
yeah.
And you had asked me, which, and I'm not an expert on this, but I would have said 75% don't have any. Not 25, 75, because my contact with small business, they don't even know what CRM is.
They don't even know who you are when you walk in for the 15th time.
Well,
yeah.
and I think that you can define a lot of the systems that companies use. They're not traditional CRM, so Microsoft Outlook is a great example. A lot of companies manage all of their contacts and all their notes and everything in Microsoft Outlook.
Mm.
It may not be the most, the easiest thing to share with your coworkers,
yeah.
but technically they're managing their customers.
Right.
So while it doesn't...
They don't do it well, but they're trying.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And I think that 75% probably
right.
loops in a bunch of stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you change the question to how many are doing it well,
that's
75% aren't doing it
probably
well.
Probably not doing it well.
Yeah.
Right.
Peter, I'm going to move on to your point number five, which is complex technology.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that I think what I said about the leveling of the playing field, they're also, as businesses are getting more sophisticated, so are their needs.
Right. Mm.
So what's happening
right.
is they're getting more savvy, but I think they're also demanding more. And so
as they get savvy, they want more. They didn't realize what they did. They didn't know what they didn't know.
Exactly.
And now they know and they want this.
And now they want more sophistication. They want automation. They want, and so, you know, that's one of the things I've seen, you know, just in the last few years has been a tremendous shift to much more sophisticated and very small companies being very sophisticated about how they market to their customers, how they do their business, you know, and I mentioned automation. Automation is one of those things where you can automate a lot of the systems and processes that you are running in your small business where you don't, you know, and this is not great for a jobs report, but you don't need as many people, but you need higher skilled people to operate these things. And so that's a whole other ball of wax, right?
But you also mentioned before that as the technology becomes more intuitive, we can actually work without a ton of training.
That's right.
With much more complex, what you could consider, would have considered complex before is becoming less complex too.
And I think that one of the things that we've seen is a lot of off-the-shelf technologies that are solving pretty complex operations. Yeah. And I'll give you one example. When you have a CRM and an accounting system, hooking those two things together used to be pretty complicated.
Yeah.
And now there's a ton of tools out there. Dell bought one called Boomi. There's this company called Zapier. There's a ton of companies that are in the business of the, I would call like plumbing for the internet.
Yeah, right.
Connect this to this, click, and it's the—
And so they can read.
They can read and write back and forth. And so that is where I would say that's a complex need that is getting solved by a pretty sophisticated piece of software.
Right.
And I'll tell you, most business owners could actually set that up themselves. It doesn't take a tech whiz to do it. You say, what's my password over here? What's my password over there?
Connect them.
Make them talk.
Right.
And you know, it's and I've seen it work. It's pretty amazing.
Cool.
So,
moving on to your point number six, which is this a redundancy here? It says data, data, data.
Yeah, but it's a good redundancy because that's just what happened. We are data inundated.
Well, so you know, we create it, we use it. There's just no shortage of it. And I think, you know, one of the things businesses are doing is they're using more photos, more video, they're using more data, they're acquiring more data, you know, so.
And pulling the information out of that data that they want.
Well, that's a key. How do you take the zettabyte of data, which is a trillion gigabytes.
Right.
So do the math there. But the,
I'd run out of ink.
I can't. I don't think
I'd run out of ink.
There's a lot of zeros.
It's just that.
But the idea that you have data is everywhere, the small businesses are creating a ton of data.
Yeah.
And I can give you some specifics. I mean, you look at how, and I mentioned automation, but a lot of these, you know, small manufacturers, you think about all the data that they're creating for the machines that are running, those things, you know, how many widgets are they cranking out? How many, you know, what are the settings on those machines?
Statistical process controls that are making sure that the quality is there, right.
And that has to come back somewhere. And one of the things we would argue that it shouldn't come back into server farms, into your office. And I would say this is a great use of cloud storage.
Back to the cloud.
Right. Push it out, because you know what? You can buy it so much cheaper from an Amazon or Google or Microsoft on a per byte basis that it doesn't make sense. It's very hard for us to justify spending money.
The investment in a
stacks and stacks of drives anymore. It doesn't make any sense. So let somebody else do it. That's their business. We always say, you know, so rent it versus buy it.
Yeah.
I think I told you YouTube video receives like 3,000 hours of running video time per minute.
Minute. So there is no physical way
to
watch all of it, right?
I can't even. I'm lost right at that point.
and I think we're creating to that. So we're actually subscribing into that by doing shows like this. So we're actually creating more videos. So.
Yeah.
There you go.
More data.
Yeah, but this is good
video. This is good stuff, right?
More data.
Yeah, that's very true.
Well, this must be the next point seven must be one of your favorites. Maybe they're all your favorites, but you must spend a lot of time with small business people on this one. This is security.
Hmm. Yeah, and actually, this is one of the things that we see, you know, time and time again, where people are not investing in enough security. Mm. And one, and a, you know, I sound like a representative for the cloud companies, but one of the things that we always say is, and when a small business owner says, oh, that cloud thing makes me nervous because of the security.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, it should make you nervous because, you know, God forbid somebody gets into that server in your office, Joe, your computer guy, is not going to be able to fix that.
That's right.
And it's way above his pay grade. Let the pros do it. And
right.
Let, you know,
they
I'll
know
tell
how
you,
to do it.
The Microsofts, the Googles, the Amazons, those guys have armies of security people. Mm. And they're credentialed up the wazoo. They take, you know, they're well-versed on the newest threats. You, as a small business owner, are not, and you will never be.
And it's not your focus.
There's some basic training that you have to understand how to make your business run securely. It's the simple stuff that we always talk about. And, you know, yes, invest in good, you know, anti-malware and things like that.
Norton, right.
Encryption.
Yep.
But teach your employees how to keep secure passwords.
Right.
What is a secure password?
Right.
Do things like two-factor authentication.
Yeah.
That's a no-brainer.
Right.
So everybody carries a mobile phone. So two-factor says something you know, so a password, and something you have.
Right.
And something you have can be your mobile phone. You can have the system say, hey, Bill, I see you're logging in. What's the code that I just sent you on your mobile phone?
Right.
And if you're not Bill and your name is Joe and you're trying to hack into Bill's computer.
He doesn't get that text.
Bill, I do.
And then I know somebody's hacking into my computer.
Exactly.
Right.
The first thing you do is go change your password.
That happened with the office in Fall River.
Sure.
They tried to log in, and I got a text. And I said, who the hell is that? Picked up the phone, called Fall River. I said, what's going on? Oh, yeah, we're trying to log in. Well, next time, tell me.
Exactly. And yep. So two-factor authentication, these two simple things. And then, obviously, you know, one of the big things we always see about security is email. Email is... You know, it's both it's the keys to your kingdom because of the fact that so much of data goes through email. So once somebody gets into your email, you're really in trouble.
You're in trouble.
And so what we try to do is try to keep the bad stuff out as much as possible. Mm. Let the pros do
what they do.
They do it really well.
My brother-in-law, 15 years ago, retired from 22 years in the Navy, and he was a security specialist for firing missiles and all that.
Wow.
And he had all that training for God knows how many years. And when he retired, he said, geez, I don't know what I'm going to do for a living from here on in. I said, are you serious?
You wrote your own ticket right there.
I said, you have knowledge that this market is going to gobble up immediately. Yeah. He immediately went to work for a big six-figure job.
Right, exactly.
He was like, what am I going to do? Oh, boy, are you in demand.
Yeah. And I think cybersecurity is a lot of it has to do with, you know, how you train your employees.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those are our two sort of simple pieces of advice. Let the pros do it and train your employees.
That's the two best pieces of advice for security. Teach your people what they should and shouldn't do. And when you got a problem, let the pros handle it.
Yeah.
Okay. They know how to do it. Yeah. And they can do it quickly and effectively.
And what you just said, I was going to ask you, and all of these points that you've been going through, there's an overlay to this, I'll call it that, which is the training aspect. I mean, a small business... is seeing more technology, getting more interested in incorporating it into the business, you know, pushing forward in that direction.
Yeah.
And the business owner can't do it by himself, him or herself.
Right.
Right.
And, you know, this training comes into the fore.
And I think don't foist new technology on your employees without giving them a heads up, understanding what the benefit is. You know, one of the things we don't want to see is we don't want to say, oh, this owner goes out and buys some big fancy system and says, okay, guys, here, to go use it, because you know what? The adoption on that will be zero. People will just not.
Well, no, they're uncomfortable with it. They're afraid of it. They haven't got a clue what to do with it.
And it happens. It happens amazingly every day that, you know, small business owners are spending money that things are not getting used. Mm. And so, CRM used to be one of those things.
Exactly.
If you know, you bought the big fancy system, it sat on the shelf for 2 years,
nobody knew how to use it, and they were afraid of it. They weren't trained.
And you got to be trained. You have to understand the business value too.
Yeah.
You know, that's where it all comes back down to. I use this system because it gives me this much, you know, this value. Like the CRM thing I'll get back to.
Mm.
You know, I know that I can walk into appointments with all the data in hand.
You know everything you need to know. You're walking in prepared.
Exactly.
You know, part of it, you know, one of the things that you're actually saying here, I want to, you know, point out the business owner, the decision maker in this case.
Yeah.
This person must not and cannot afford to say, take a new technology idea and throw it at his people, even right. if he or she is providing training,
right.
he or she has to understand it and be behind it.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, for instance, CRM. You take CRM. We're going to get really advanced on CRM and make best use of that idea. And I'm the owner, and I throw it at my people and say, here, go do something with it. I don't think I can do that. I've got to know what CRM right. is. Which direction it's going, and be enthusiastic and push it. You're a president.
And walk the and talk. leverage the what's coming out of it.
Right.
So, and how do you do that as an executive or a business owner? Is set up the dashboards. So you want to know how many new leads are we getting every day? What's the opportunity funnel look like? What are our new sales on a daily basis?
Right.
You have a CRM that's well tuned. You can tell exactly right away. All the stats, all the key performance indicators that you need to know to run that business.
Right.
Okay. That's great. Well, this has been a good session.
I learned a lot.
Thank you.
Always do when I'm with you.
Peter. This is the Fox Robbins Business Show. Thank you for watching. And feel free to send any comments, ideas, suggestions, complaints. Well, not too many of those. To foxrobbins@gmail.com.
Send the complaints to him.
And we will see you guys next time.